Good evening there, Pipe Pals and Gals. Old Holy Smoking Pipe Padre coming back at you again with another video. I'm happy to go through a scandemic with you any day of the week and twice on Sundays. So I raise a little glass here of my little liquid libation, little cold coffee with some cream. Oh, boy, that is good. Along with a a pipe. Burning briar. I believe this is a Dunhill root briar that I got, oh gosh, several years ago, back when I was in Elk Grove and going to the briar patch there in Loman Center, which I have been told is no longer there. So a little piece of history for the old Padre, recent history, but still a beautiful, beautiful pipe. She's a good girl. And in it I'm smoking. I was thinking about doing some W.O. Larson. It's autumnal time now for most of us. And up here at in the hinterlands, it is getting a bit chilly, not frosty, but chilly, chilly. So, not quite cold enough for W.O. Larson. Good winter blend. Maybe a little, anticipating just a little bit too much. So I did find some tinderbox. Excuse me. Tinderbox. Went down the wrong tube there. This is kind of like a autumn blend. Kind of like a caramel. I don't know. I opened it up and I went, oh, that's perfect. That's perfect. So, yeah. So anyway, I am here. Just got through reading a letter. Nice letter by the one, the only, the inimitable Gap. Gary Portier, Mr. Pear Tree himself. So I just thought I'd get on here. I know that probably a few of you, I'm being a bit, being a bit immodest by saying this, but maybe, just maybe, there's a few of you out there that are wondering, where's the old Padre? Where's old Holy Smoking Pipe Padre? Old HSPP himself? To tell us what he thinks about the debates. More on that in a minute, yeah. So if a few of you are out there were waiting, anticipating anxiously for an HSPP video on the debates, well, my friends, this video is for you. And then after I do that, I'm gonna talk to you about this. Can I get it to zoom in there? Hold on a second. See if anybody knows what this is. Anybody know what that is? Okay, we're gonna talk about that probably at the end of the video. Okay. Because I just was reading Gary's little missive there, and he says that you all, because I don't frequent you as much as I'd like to, and some of you are probably grateful that I don't frequent as much as I would like, but about telling stories that kind of, personal stories about your life, maybe, or things that are important to you or had meaning and significance, other than just enjoying a good pipe on an autumn evening like I'm doing tonight. Got my old Denny lighter here. This has been a real champ, gotta tell you. It's kind of like an M1 Abrams tank. It just keeps on going. It needs some. It needs a little TLC, as you can see there. But some of those burn marks kind of give it character. Yeah, give it character. So. Okay, camera's there. Okay. All right, so let me kind of move back. Move back a little bit here. Let's move up. Got a Sandhauser mic here. And Mike, if you're watching, that's a little shout out to you. Get it, Mike? Old college buddy, old ROTC buddy, Mike. Yeah, great guy. And a pipe smoker. He used to have these Bingle, these replica, I guess they're replicas. Maybe the original Bing Crosby pipes, but they were really awesome. Good old Bing Crosby pipes. I heard the horn. I thought I heard my horn and my truck blowing out. Huh. There. I guess just a radio. Okay. Are you guys ready for this? Some of you are not going to believe what I was going to say here. I was going to put on an extra light. I was thinking about doing that. But you know what? I think it wouldn't be quite, I don't think it'd be quite right. Extra light, even though I think it might do a little fill. I don't know if it's necessary. No. Anyway, so last week, today is October the 8th, and last night we had the VP debate, and last Tuesday night we had the first presidential debate, and it looks like at this recording, believe it or not, folks, that's it. You're not getting any more, okay? So if you're coming back for seconds, forget it. Ain't gonna happen. Okay, so now I don't usually watch Communist Network News, or was it CNN? Yeah, Communist Network News. So I don't normally watch them, but I have to say, and I gotta, you know, I'm a very, I think I'm a pretty, you know, respectful guy. I'm objective for the most part. I try to be. And, you know, I know some people might choose to debate that, say, no, you're this or that, whatever. And that's okay too. Still a free country, at least for a few more months, maybe. Who knows? We'll have to wait and see. but anyway, I think it was Jake Tapper said that the first presidential debate was a hot mess in a dumpster fire, in a train wreck. Now, I have to say, it was a well-crafted line. Okay, now do I totally agree with him? Was it really a hot mess in a dumpster fire in a train wreck? Well, we'll talk about that. But let's cut to the chase, shall we? But first, let me light my pipe. Oh, I got a new idea. Okay, YouTube pipe community, here's a new idea. I don't know if it's ever been done before. And if it's been done before, say, HSPP, you are so behind. We've already done that. But how about a video? How about a contest to see how long you can talk and smoke at the same time without relighting your pipe? Just saying, that might be a kind of a cool contest. How long can you go without having to relight your pipe in a video? Now, I think old Tom from Northwest Pipe Smoker, I think I got that right. He'd probably win. I would just say he wins because I just think that when it comes to talking with your pipe and your teeth, he has it hands down. No doubt about it. Me, on the other hand, I could probably go maybe 4 or 5 minutes, maybe. But why bother? That's why God invented lighters, so we can relight our pipes. But anyway, just thought of that. Just throwing that out there, YouTube pipe community. Little contest kind of a thing. Hey, you know, kind of a cool idea, I think. But what do I know? Ah, oh, that's good. Okay, so who won the first presidential debate? Hands down, no questions. Joe Biden. And who won the vice president debate last night? Clearly, undisputed Kamala Harris, however you pronounce her name. But clearly, she won. So, Joe Biden won the first one, and Kamala, however you say her name, I like to call her Karen, won last night's debate. Now, some of you are probably falling out of your chairs right now. And what I'm saying is absolutely true. According to CNN and MSNBC. Now, do I think that those people won? No, of course not. Not a chance, folks. Never. Come on. No, come on. Be real. Be real. I am being real. No. I really, according to CNN and CBS and NBC and ABC and, you know, and I guess RT, what, Russia Today and all those, Al Jazeera and, yeah, those two won hands down. No doubt about it, right? Okay. If you believe that, I have a bridge in Brooklyn I'd love to talk to you about. Okay. Honestly, guys, seriously though, I think let's start with the VP debate last night, which was certainly a little more, so shall we say, civilized, had a little more decorum going for the most part. but I think that that both candidates were just kind of hiding behind their talking points. That's just my humble opinion. And when they were pressed to get more substantive, they were lacking. And then also, the other thing that I felt was disingenuous was that that a lot of times they just put up their straw men, and you know, as if it were facts. And yeah, it's kind of, that's a tricky little game people can play. And if you don't know the truth, yeah, it's going to go, well, I didn't know that, huh? You know, the little bit about Abraham Lincoln thing, that was totally beyond the pale, you know, historically didn't even happen. But anyway, and the thing about getting back to Amy Coney Barrett, the thing is that the reason why, Joe Obama, sorry, I was going to make a bumper sticker, you know, Obama, O'Biden, oh no, because I thought it was O'Biden at one time, because I thought he was Irish, but anyway, I was going to go Obama, O'Biden, oh no, okay, that's just my little bumper sticker idea. If you want to use it, you're free to use it, I'll give you the royalties, okay, there you go. but the thing is that, you know, Obama was truly a lame duck president. Now, I know a lot of you folks are hoping that Donald J. Trump, I haven't been drinking anything alcoholic for a long time. It is good, though. It's not alcoholic, though. But, you know, some of you out there are hoping that the current incumbent is going to be a one-term president, and he may very well be. However, my favorite coordinating conjunction, at this point, he is still the 45th president of the United States, and he will remain the 45th president of the United States until January, whenever the, you know, inauguration, providing he loses. Now, there's, yeah, the polls are showing massive leads for Joe Biden. Why? Hell if I know. I just think it's creative numbers. I think, and to be honest with you, I think it's just downright, I think it's fraudulent. You know, I mean, look at the same scenarios kind of being played out again. You know, Hillary's going to win by this massive landslide, and the polls, you know, she's always ahead, you know, thousands of points ahead, and blah, 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 blah. And you know what? Polls don't really mean a whole lot. but votes do. Now, that's where it's going to get really interesting with all this mail-in voting. Now, I know some people, they're going, we've had mail-in voting ever since. No, that's absentee ballots that you mail in. Yes, but it's not where you automatically get a ballot and they just, you fill it out and send it in. And a lot of this stuff is, they're hoping, I hear that, you know, Ruth Bader Ginsburg is going to be voting by mail this year. So, you know, a lot of people like her will be voting by mail, you know, and a lot of other people that are here illegally will be voting by mail, you know. So sadly, yes, we may not know. And this is what, this is scary because it looks like they're setting it up already to say, okay, yeah, maybe President Trump will, looks like he'll win the night of the election, but wait, there's more. We've never had that before, folks. This is a, and you know, and the reason why people get upset when President Trump says, hey, you know, am I going to concede? Well, we got to wait, make sure it's a valid election before anybody concedes. And that goes the other way too. You know, I don't want to see a fraudulent vote. Either way, I want to see a fair, legitimate ballot. And I think that we're going to be finding ourselves in some real murky waters if we are continuing to go this mail-in ballot thing. Just my opinion, but why are we changing the rules now? Why are we doing this? Why can't we just keep things the way they were? Well, I think the answer is kind of obvious to a lot of people. The people that are not in power want power, and they want it badly. And then they're going to try to do anything they can. I hear that the lady who's the Speaker of the House, I don't even want to mention her name because she doesn't deserve it. She's a snake. We started this whole thing with the Russia, Russia, Russia. Then we went to the impeachment, and now it looks like they're going to try. I mean, they've tried everything that they can to just, you know, attack this man. Whether you like him or not, it's this. I've been around this old dirt ball for 60 some odd years. I've never seen it this way before. Never. There's always been contentiousness between the political parties. But it seems to me that what's happening is, and I guess, and now I'm finding out more and more that it looks like the younger generation has been totally turned off on our country, and they don't want to save this country. They want to dismantle it. They have been brainwashed to think, well, the only way we're ever going to make this a better place is to get rid of the United States, destroy it, and start all over again. And they're in the process of doing it as we speak. And that's a scary thing. The Constitution has no more value for these people. And if it doesn't have any value, if it's not the document that, you know, it's not divine revelation, folks, but it's pretty doggone close. It's you know, again, is it, you know, I think I've said this in previous videos. There's no perfect society. There's no perfect people. There's no perfect nation. But by golly, we have one thing that a lot of people don't have in the world, and that's freedom. Freedom, okay? So if you want to believe what you want to believe, and as long as you don't hurt anybody else, you have the freedom right now to do that. But there are a lot of people now that don't want that. Nope, they want the government to tell you when you can sit down, stand up, take a poop, go get a drink of water. It's almost like being in the Marine Corps boot camp. I think, but even though Marine Corps boot camp had a little bit more freedom than what some of these people are hoping for. And I just wish people would do just a little bit of reading of history to know that socialism starts off, it's a great ideal, and it's a horrible reality. So, but, you know, I'm getting close to the end here of cashing in my chips, you know. I won't be here much longer. But the thing is that the next generation's behind us. I mean, what kind of a world will they have? What kind of a, they don't even want a country, it sounds like. They want utopia, and every time utopia has been tried, it leads to mass graves. That's all I'm going to say about that. So I will encourage all of you to get out there and vote. I probably won't be making any more videos until after the election. providing I have the freedom to do so. And I've been looking at YouTube, and every single little YouTube video that I click on, it has a little, one of those little advertisement videos, and they're all anti-Trump. Anti-Trump videos. I mean, let's face it. I mean, if you're a kind of a conservative Christian type person like I am, you can't help but notice that it's all YouTube and Facebook. They're in it for Biden. No doubt about it. And I have no problem with political debates. I have no problem with political ads. But by golly, why can't you keep it fair? Why can't you have a Biden campaign ad once and then a Trump one next? You know, kind of rotate it back and forth. At least give equal time. But they're not going to do that. Nope, they're going to. And all the ones that I've seen are really a bunch of straw man lies and fantasies. And they're just built on rage and anger. And it's like, it'd be refreshing to see an objective, you know, a place where people could go and say, okay, yeah, President Trump said this. Did he keep his promise? Yes, he did. Or no, he didn't. Or yes and kind of no. You know, yes a little bit, no a little bit, you know. But you're not going to hear that. It's all orange man bad. That's all it is, orange man bad. You know, the guy can't win anything. I mean, he's been nominated for 3 Nobel Peace Prizes. And the other news agencies don't even tell you that. You probably, if you heard me say that, you said, oh, come on, that's a lie. How many people out there heard me say Donald Trump was nominated for 3 Nobel Peace Prizes? How many of you kind of like, get real? No, there's no way in H-E-double-2 he was. But you will never hear that on mainstream media, you know? So it's just, I want objectivity. That's what I want. I don't, you know, some of you might think I'm just in it. You know, I'm on the Trump train and, you know, you know, full speed ahead. Well, you know, I'm not going to lie and say that I don't support our president. Of course I do. I think he's done a great job. Why do I think he's done a great job? Because I think he's keeping freedom alive. Okay. But in the country that Biden and Kamala Harris will usher in, it's almost like, well, maybe, you know, say goodbye to this, folks, because this is politically incorrect. This is a big no-no. Tobacco, come on. They've already, you know, pretty much made it almost, I wouldn't say next to impossible, but they have certainly put lots of restrictions on tobacco products. And all they'd have to do is just say, well, we're going to outlaw it. Can't smoke no more. Sorry. You know, they come in and then come to your house and they, you know, they're going to maybe look through your house and they find things like this. You know, and you say, well, I'm just collecting it. Maybe you're not smoking it anymore, but you have it on your shelf. Maybe you had a collection of pipes from your dad, your granddad, or your uncle, and they're just collector pieces. Oh, no, you've been smoking. To the gulag you go. You know? And we won't even talk about the rooty-tooty point-and-shooties. Nope. We won't be talking about this. Won't be talking about this right here, Rudy Tooty Point and Shooties, because if this is bad and they're going to confiscate that and tell you it's illegal, well, I don't even want to go into that discussion. Whoops. So anyway, hope you're having a good evening. There we are. Let me calm down, get my blood pressure a little bit lower here. Okay, so I kind of got on my political soapbox, and thank you for humoring me. Okay, so let me get my pipe going again. Listen to a little KXPR in the background. That radio station, believe it or not, has been on the air for almost 40 years, a little over 40 years. And I remember being a young man and being able to finally find a classical station. And well, they play jazz at night. But they used to play, their program schedule was they'd do early morning news from NPR. I'd wake up with that. And then they play mostly classical music throughout the day. And then about 6 o'clock or 5 o'clock, they do the jazz thing. And then 11 o'clock, when they'll do that now tonight, they'll go back to classical music and through the early morning hours. They don't play on the classical station any more news. I mean, they have a specifically dedicated news channel that you can listen to if that's what you want to listen to. If you want to listen to news all day, you can. If you want to listen to jazz all day, you can. If you want to listen to classical music all day, you can. So, and I was never really a big jazz person, but then later in life, I kind of acquired the taste. So there's some things that I kind of liked, and there's some things that I've enjoyed throughout the years. And I think it makes a nice kind of a mellow background when I make my videos. Yeah. Well, let's go ahead. Let's kind of get to the last part of this video, because maybe some of you are like, okay, you got off your soapbox on the Trump thing and the voting thing. So what was all this little doodad here? What's all this about? I think most of you know this is just a little backing for thousands, billions, billions and billions of little stick pin type things. And you're probably wondering, well, what went to that? Well, I got to be honest with you, I don't know what went to this specific one, but this little guy here has kind of a very sentimental relationship or correlation to my life. And I know it might sound weird. In fact, it just hit me today, probably like 55 years later. Golly, that's kind of old. I'm old. But anyway, I remember I was looking for one of these for an awful long time. And I'll tell you why. When I was a little boy, I remember I wanted to be in the Cub Scouts. And I remember a few years back when I was in Elk Grove, it kind of tickled me. I guess there was I was driving through a neighborhood on the way back from the river. Used to be driving my river runs. Maybe some of you may remember those videos, my beautiful Highway 160 runs down the river and Sacramento River. And anyway, I was coming back to Elk Grove one afternoon or late afternoon, early evening, and there was a sign out which tickled me, "Join the Cub Scouts." And I thought, oh, they still have the Cub Scouts? Really? I didn't know they even had those anymore. But when I was a little boy, I got a chance to join the Cub Scouts. And it was exciting because I got to wear the uniform and, you know, you got to do cool things, you know. I probably was more of a dangerous Cub Scout because some of the things that I'd read about in those books, you know, those craft things, because what you do is you make all these crafts and little soapbox derby thing. And I remember there was one where you could burn lettering into wood. And obviously there's a tool for that. Well, I grew up in a little apartment in, you know, downtown Auburn, and we didn't have, you know, the tools to do that kind of burning. So I found my mom's cigarette matches and started lighting those and trying to burn the wood that way. That was pretty doggone dangerous, I found out later. I didn't start a fire, thanks be to God, in the house, but I could have. I could have burned the whole apartment place down. It was like, oh my gosh, what are you doing? I'm trying to burn my name in this wood, you know? It's like, no, no, no. I was a dangerous Cub Scout. But anyway, but the thing about this was, this little backing, oh, I almost lost it again. There we go, I'm gonna lose it again. Boy, I'm getting old. Okay, so I think the very first little award that I ever won in my little life was the Bobcat pin. I don't have one with me now. I was looking at them online this morning. Now, what started all this is earlier this morning, as I was setting up for Mass in the church, I was going through, we just had our outdoor of our church painted, and it looks, I think it looks beautiful, it looks great. The most important thing is it sealed up all the raw wood that we had exposed. And some of the wood, some of the old paint was cracking after about 12, 15 years. So the place needed a paint job. So, you know, this summer I, you know, in addition to getting the roof done for the church, we got our paint. I was just so happy. We've been moving kind of forward on doing a lot of renovation, and it's just great. So I was inside and I was kind of looking at some of the inside of the little sills, the window sills. And as I looked down, I saw this little backing. And it reminded me, it hit me. And I went, I remember how much I was looking for one of those little backings, you know, 55 years ago. So what happened was this. I got to join the Cub Scouts. This person, we didn't have a lot of money, but this person, they felt that, you know, the Cub Scouts things would be a good thing for me because it probably teach me a little bit of discipline and kind of some social skills, you know, how to interact with other kids, because I was kind of a, you know, kid that just didn't do a whole lot, you know, and there was reasons for that, but basically, you know, I didn't get a chance to do after school stuff. So anyway, this person kind of took an interest in me, and they said, well, maybe he'd like to join the Cub Scouts. And I wanted to, because you got to wear a uniform, and I thought that was cool, and you got to do all the kind of the club stuff that I never got a chance to do. So it was like, oh, I want to do this. So anyway, I remember you had to learn, I guess, the Cub Scout salute and handshake and the secret things and the little motto. And I remember learning all that. And after you learn all those things, you get to get your first awards, which is your little bobcat pin. And so I remember how important that was, because my mom pinned it on me and I just felt so proud. I just was so proud. I was so proud, I started wearing my little bobcat pin on my regular shirts. You know, wore it to school. I remember kind of like looking at it all the time. Like, look, I got this award. I got it. Well, the problem was that I would kind of like try to show it to my friends. And as I pulled on it, unbeknownst to me, the little backing would fall off. And then later the little bobcat pin would fall off and I lost it. So I remember I was devastated. And then I remember kind of going back to the Cub Scout leader and telling him, hey, I lost my pin, and could I get another one? And so they said, okay, sure. You know, so they gave me another one. And wouldn't you know, I was again wearing it proudly and at school, and I lost it again, the little backing, lost that thing again, lost this little sucker here, and I lost the pin again. And I think the third time I went back, they kind of said, enough's enough. We're going to give you one more, but if you lose that other bet, you're done. We're not giving you any more. Okay, I thought it was fair. Well, you guessed it. I lost this backing one more time. And after that, I realized, well, such is life. C'est la vie. You know, so much for my bobcat pin. I think it, I don't know where it, maybe I lost it again. It didn't just set off, forget it, or maybe I don't know, but I remember looking for this thing diligently at school. I was looking for this up and down all along the playground because I lost it. And if I didn't have this backing, I couldn't wear my bobcat pin. Yeah, I know. Tragedy. But anyway, this morning I found it. And now if I find my bobcat pin, I can wear it again. Just say it. So that's my little story. Hopefully you got something out of it. So again, I thank you so much for putting up with the old Holy Smoking Pie Padre, folks. Hope you're having a great evening. And, you know, whether you're supporting, you know, old Joe, or you're supporting Donald J, let's hope and pray that Election Day things will be A-okay. All right, take care. And light up your world, my friends. You know, don't let the political bed bugs bite, and, you know, light up your world, light up your pipe. Enjoy. See you now.